We are beginning the program shortly. The guests are arriving. I request everyone to kindly rise. I request Advocate Akshay Sudame, Associate Convener, Study Circle, to escort Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice of the Honorable Bombay High Court and Patron-in-Chief of the Study Circle, onto the dais. I now request Advocate Virat Mishra, Associate Convener, to kindly escort Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar, Senior Judge, Honorable Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench, onto the dais. I request Advocate Vishwajit Oberoi, Library in Charge of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly escort Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya, the Honorable the Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court, onto the dais. I now request Advocate Prithviraj Chauhan, Joint Secretary of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly escort Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman, former Judge of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, onto the dais. Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Nariman, former Judge, Supreme Court of India. Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyay, the Honorable the Chief Justice, Bombay High Court. Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar, Senior Judge, Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench. Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice, Bombay High Court. Honorable Judges of the Bombay High Court, former Judges, Mrs. Nariman, respected Senior Advocates present, Shri Anand Deshpande, Government Pleader, Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench. Shri Nandesh Deshpande, Deputy Solicitor General of India, Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench. Learned members of the judiciary, learned members of the bar, respected principals and faculty of law colleges of Nagpur, esteemed invitees, members of the legal fraternity, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the High Court Bar Association, Nagpur, I, Advocate Astha Sharma, welcome you all to late Shri Vinod Bobde, Senior Advocate Memorial, High Court Bar Association Study Circle. The High Court Bar Association, Nagpur, was established in the year 1922 and is a century-old association of advocates practicing before the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court. The High Court Bar Association has an illustrious history and has produced many legal stalwarts. This year is special as the High Court Bar Association is celebrating its centenary year. The High Court Bar Association Study Circle has been an ongoing event since 2011, organizing guest lectures and workshops by honorable judges, legal luminaries, and senior advocates on various topics of law for grooming the budding lawyers. Late Shri Vinod Arvind Bobde, senior advocate, hailed from Nagpur and was a proud member of the High Court Bar Association. He was designated as senior advocate of the Supreme Court of India at the age of 36 in the year 1986 by the Supreme Court of India. He was the youngest designated senior advocate in the country in the Supreme Court at the time of his designation. Recently, we have christened the High Court Bar Association Study Circle to late Shri Vinod Bobde Senior Advocate Memorial High Court Bar Association Study Circle to honor and to immortalize the memory of late Shri Vinod Bobde, who has made the Nagpur Bar proud by his phenomenal achievement in the legal profession. He was, is, and will always be highly respected in the Nagpur Bar. I now request the honorable dignitaries on the dais to kindly light the traditional lamp and inaugurate today's function. Thank you, dignitaries. I now request Advocate Atul Pandey, President of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly welcome Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman with a sapling. I now invite Shri Atul Amol Jaltare, Secretary of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly welcome the Honorable the Chief Justice, Shri Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya, with a sapling. I request Advocate Firdos Mirza, Convener of the Study Circle, to kindly welcome Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar with a sapling. I now request Shri Makrand Agnihotri, Convener of the Study Circle, to kindly welcome Shri B.P. Dharmadhikari with a sapling. I now invite Advocate Apurva Kolhe, Executive Member of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly welcome Mrs. Nariman with a bouquet. Thank you, ma'am. I request Shri Atul Pandey, President of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly deliver his welcome address.
Esteemed Speaker of today's lecture, Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman, former Judge, Supreme Court of India. Chief guest of today's program, Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya, the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court. Honorable Shri Justice A.S. Chandurkar, Senior Administrative Judge of Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench. Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice of Bombay High Court and the Patron in Chief of the Study Circle. Honorable Judges of Bombay High Court, former Judges of Bombay High Court, Shri V.S. Sarpurkar, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, Mrs. Nariman, learned Judges of District and Session Court and Tribunals, respected Senior Advocates, esteemed members of HCBA, learned in charge government pleader, Shri Anand Deshpande, Shri Nandesh Deshpande, Deputy Solicitor General, members of Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa, Vice Chancellors, Principals, Students of Law Fraternity, Shri R.N. Joshi, Registrar General, Shri Ajay Losatwar, Shri Ravi Sadrani, Officers of Registry and all other dignitaries present here. I extend a warm and cordial welcome to each and every one of you on behalf of High Court Bar Association on the inaugural lecture of the newly named late Shri Vinod Bobde Senior Advocate Memorial High Court Bar Association Study Circle. The HCBA Study Circle has been an ongoing event since 2011, which consists of guest lectures and workshops by sitting and retired judges, legal luminaries, and senior advocates on various topics of law for grooming budding lawyers. Late Shri Vinod Arvind Bobde, Senior Advocate, hailed from Nagpur and was a proud member of HCBA. He was designated as Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court of India at the age of 36 in the year 1986. The Executive Committee has renamed the HCBA Study Circle to late Shri Vinod Bobde Senior Advocate Memorial High Court Bar Association Study Circle to immortalize the memory of Senior Advocate Bobde. As we all know, today being Ghatasthapana, the first day of Navratri, it is a privilege that we are able to have the first lecture of this renamed study circle on this auspicious day with the blessings of Ma Ambe. I pray to Almighty to bless the entire legal fraternity, and may we all embrace new prospective and opportunities. For this inaugural lecture, we are privileged to have Honorable Shri Justice R.F. Nariman, former Judge Supreme Court of India, with us to discourse on the topic the Nuremberg and Tokyo trial, the rule of law vindicated. Justice R.F. Nariman is a legal luminary whose knowledge on comparative constitutional and civil law is unparalleled. I am sure most of us already religiously follow his lecture series on his YouTube channel, Justice Nariman Official, and therefore we are even more curious to attend his lecture today. I am sure his wisdom and experience will undoubtedly enrich our understanding. As we embark on this intellectual journey, let us embrace the wisdom that will be shared with us. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya, the Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, who on our request, and that too on a very short notice, consented to be the chief guest of this event. Sir, your august presence added an extra charm to the event. Further, I, on behalf of HCBA, express my gratitude to Honorable Shri Justice A.S. Chandurkar, Senior Administrative Judge of Bombay High Court Nagpur Bench, Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, and the Patron in Chief of the Study Circle, who are constant source of guidance to the Study Circle and have always given their unconditional support in our various initiatives. I would like to take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to Senior Advocate Shri Sunil Manohar, who guided us to rename the HCBA Study Circle to late Shri Vinod Bobde Senior Advocate Memorial High Court Bar Association Study Circle, and has played an important role in the same. Once again, I welcome you all to this enlightening lecture. May our mind be receptive, and may the experience leave a notable mark on our intellectual pursuits. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari and Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar have been pillars of support and inspiration to all of us in all our endeavors. Their lordships have been guiding forces for us in the various activities undertaken in the study circle, and they always provide the High Court Bar Association with an impetus to fulfill our dreams and give shape to our ideas. My lords have also encouraged lawyers, young and old, to strive to achieve higher and better standards in the field. I request Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari, the Patron in Chief of the Study Circle, to kindly enlighten us with a few words.
Good evening to all of you. Honorable Justice Nariman, keynote speaker for this late Shri Vinod Bobde Senior Advocate, Memorial High Court Bar Association, Nagpur Study Circle Lecture. Our chief guest and Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, Shri Upadhyaya, Senior Judge at Nagpur, Shri Chandurkar. The person, because of his kind generosity, this function and lecture has become possible, Advocate Arjun Bobde. Shri Pandey, President of High Court Bar Association, Shri Jaltare, Secretary of High Court Bar Association, Honorable Justice Sirpurkar, former Judge of Supreme Court, Mrs. Sirpurkar, Mrs. Nariman, other Honorable Judges of the High Court at Nagpur, the past Judges of the High Court, and all other dignitaries, I wish to be as brief as possible. The High Court is very old. As per available records, the Bar Association itself has been functioning since 1922, but it was then a Court of Judicial Commissioner. Sir Hari Singh Gaur was then the president of this association, and he continued as president for about 14 years, that is till 1936. In the meanwhile, in 1933, the Court of Judicial Commissioner was converted into a High Court because latest patent was issued. And since then, the bar has a tradition of preparing juniors. Contribution of Shri Hari Singh Gaur to the bar and also to the adjudicatory process is well known. I need not say anything about it. This Bar Association is home to well-known senior advocates. It has provided the Advocate Generals to state, also Chief Justices of India, judges to Supreme Court, judges to High Court, and all advocates, whether designated or not, are well prepared and attempt to contribute to the process of making justice. All this has become possible because of help of seniors like Shri Vinod Bobde. I have seen him in practice for some time in 1980. My first independent case was against him, and many may not believe, but it was before a civil judge junior division, and one Mr. P.G. Saudhari was the judge. And during that he also guided me. It was concerning the provisions of Nagpur Municipal Corporation Act. So he told me how I have to approach that act. And I, as it was relating to tax demand, how I have to study the point. And I have seen since then, means even if some junior is arguing the matter and senior finds that he is not making the point or is missing something, he will just stand up, go to him and stop his arguments, tell something in his ear, try to correct him. Now this tradition has been going on. My friends, this is the profession in which after completing formal education, we are all trying to self-educate ourselves. Self-study, self-education is a very difficult thing. And it becomes possible because of active help from seniors, gurus. About 900 years back, Sant Jnaneshwar has said, Aani Granthopa Jivye Visheshi Lokiye Drushta Drushta Vijay Huai. About 400 to 500 years back, Samarth Ramdas wrote, Kelyane Deshatana Pandita Maitri Sabheta Sanchara. Now, this stands very true for our profession. Our profession itself is dependent on precedents, that is, past experiences. And therefore, we learn continuously from our seniors, from precedents. Now, this effort by study circle, therefore, is to enable the junior members to inculcate, I will say passively, the experience and learning of the eminent towering persons like Justice Nariman. We have got another person in the shape of Chief Justice of this High Court. We are shortly going to approach his office for a convenient date so that he will also be available to us for guiding. But this experience and his interpretation and his thoughts on war crimes, involvement of political officials therein, their prosecution, first formation of tribunal, all is definitely going to help us because it is ultimately the rule of law which needs to be maintained and vindicated. With this, I will give rise to my thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you, my Lord, for your words of enlightenment and highlighting the importance of guidance of seniors in the profession. Thank you for your unwavering support and guidance throughout. Born on 16 June 1965 at Muskerai district of Uttar Pradesh, Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya graduated from Lucknow University in 1991 and was enrolled as an advocate on 11th May 1991. My Lord initially practiced with his father, Shri R. A. Upadhyaya, and later joined the chambers of Senior Advocate Muhammad Arif Khan in 1991 and the chambers of Senior Advocate S. K. Kalia in 1997. In the year 2007, His Lordship was appointed as Chief Standing Counsel for the state of Uttar Pradesh and continued in this position till his elevation as Additional Judge of the Allahabad High Court in 2011. His Lordship was appointed as the 47th Chief Justice of the Honorable Bombay High Court in July 2023. We are honored by your august presence today, my Lord. I now request Honorable Shri Justice Upadhyaya to enlighten us with a few words.
Esteemed Speaker of this evening, Hon'ble Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, Mrs. Nariman, my esteemed brother Shri Justice A.S. Chandurkar, and brother and sister judges of Bombay High Court at Nagpur, Shri Justice Sirpurkar, former judge, Supreme Court of India, Shri Justice Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice, Bombay High Court, and Patron in Chief of this study circle, Shri Atul Pandey, President of High Court Bar Association at Nagpur, Shri Amol Jiltare, Secretary of the Association, Shri Arjun Bobde, Advocate and other members of his family, senior advocates and law students, all other distinguished guests, and my dear students, ladies and gentlemen. A very good evening and namaskar to all of you present here. First and foremost, I express my gratitude to the study circle of the Bar Association to have given me this opportunity to be part of this inaugural lecture to commemorate late Vinod Bobde, senior advocate, a son of the soil of Nagpur, who excelled in the profession and marked his presence in a big, big way in the judicial fraternity. Late Vinod Bobde does not need any introduction to this gathering today. Though I did not have the fortune to have ever met late Vinod Bobde, however, as a lawyer, I have had immense appreciation for him. On a few occasions, while attending matters in the Honorable Supreme Court, I heard a lot about him, that how he was one of the best and most sought after counsels to be engaged for final hearing matters in the Supreme Court. One of my colleagues at Allahabad High Court at Lucknow, who has been my friend since my days as lawyers, once told me that if anyone was to be engaged as a senior counsel in the Supreme Court for a final hearing matter, it had to be necessarily late Vinod Bobde. This was his reputation. It is therefore a matter of pride that Nagpur has produced such a legal luminary of eminence. It is less an honor and more a privilege and fortune to be present on the occasion of this memorial lecture, also for the reason that I will have this opportunity to listen to a speaker of repute, far and wide, Justice Rohinton. Great philosopher of Greece used to say that we should have scholar kings. We have a scholar judge, and if I may be permitted to say so, we have a scholar who has been a judge as well. We are all acquainted with his judgments and his views on the voice of dissent. Those who have read two volumes of his book, Discordant Notes, Voice of Dissent, will find how articulate has Justice Rohinton been in tracing the voices of dissent in Indian judiciary, right from Justice Mahmood, who was the first Indian jurist to be appointed as a judge of High Court of Judicature at Allahabad. He was the son of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, who is known for reforms in the field of education. Having established Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College at Aligarh, which later developed into Aligarh Muslim University, Justice Mahmood was a great dissenter, and Justice Rohinton remembers him in his book Discordant Notes with reverence. Justice Mahmood was appointed as a district judge at Raibareli in Uttar Pradesh at the age of 29 years, and it was within 3 years that he was nominated to officiate as a judge on the High Court at the early age of 31 years. How was he chosen to adorn the office of a judge at the High Court is interesting to note. His expression of flaw in his judgment in the case of Deputy Commissioner Raibareli versus Raja Rampal Singh, which he had delivered as a district judge, struck the members of the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council, and while expressing their concurrence with the judgment of Justice Mahmood as district judge in appeal in the Privy Council conveyed to the Secretary of State for India that such a talented person should not be wasted in the district judiciary. And that is how Justice Mahmood was elevated to the bench of High Court at such an early age. As for the topic of the lecture, the Nuremberg trials are a milestone in shaping the international law after the Second World War. There has been no precedent for an international trial of war criminals prior to Nuremberg trials. It was a trial by a tribunal which comprised of judges from the victorious countries, one each from United States, USSR, United Kingdom, and France. Therefore, in some circles, it is criticized as victor's justice. Similarly, International Military Tribunal for the Far East, also known as Tokyo War Crimes Tribunal, was established under a proclamation of the Supreme Commander of Allied Forces, General MacArthur, again from a victor nation. Association of Justice Radha Vinod Pal, an Indian jurist with Tokyo trials, may be of some interest to the audience here. He voted in the trial for acquittal of all defendants. His dissent runs into 1,230 pages. Conspicuously, the Emperor of Japan, Hirohito, and his family did not face the trial. It was only Tojo and others. They were tried for crimes against peace, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. Justice Pal rejected these notions of crimes against peace and crimes against humanity and declared that these were invented only on account of thirst for revenge. He was one who categorized nuclear bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki as criminal acts of World War II. All these aspects are going to be dealt with today by Justice Nariman in his lecture, which will commence soon. Justice Nariman's voice of dissent travels from Justice Mahmood to this day via Justice Radha Vinod Pal. And I don't want to remain between you and the distinguished speaker today anymore. So I conclude. Thank you very much.
Thank you, my lord. Your lordship's words have only made us more eager to listen to our esteemed guest speaker for the evening. Our esteemed speaker for the occasion is Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman. After graduating from Faculty of Law, University of Delhi, my lord completed his master's from Harvard Law School. His lordship then joined the bar in 1979 and was considered to be an expert in comparative constitutional law and civil law, having over 500 reported Supreme Court judgments to his credit. During his career as a lawyer, my lord handled several high-profile cases, including the Sakharam Binder case, the Enercon case on the seat of arbitration, the P.A. Inamdar case on reservation policy of minority educational institutions, the dispute of Reliance Industries, the Khore Distilleries case, which is a milestone in trademark law, among very many others. Intriguingly enough, my lord also is an ordained priest from the Bandra Agiary and has given several lectures and religious talks all over the world. While it is well known that his lordship was directly elevated from the bar to be the judge of the Honorable Supreme Court of India, another remarkable accomplishment is that my lord was only 37 when he was designated as a senior counsel. The then Chief Justice of India, Shri Venkatachalaya, amended the rules as the minimum age to become a senior counsel was at that time 45. My lord was appointed as the Solicitor General of India on 23rd July 2011 and then elevated to the bench on 7th July 2014 and retired on 12th August 2021. His lordship's varied interests also include a profound knowledge of history, philosophy, literature, science, and fascinatingly, Western classical music. My lord has been recognized as one of the world heroes by Access Now, an international human rights organization, for his judgment in K.S. Puttuswamy versus Union of India, recognizing the right to privacy as a fundamental right under Article 21 of the Constitution of India. We are indeed honored and privileged to have such an eminent jurist and scholar amongst us to deliver the lecture today. I now humbly request Honorable Shri Justice Nariman to deliver the lecture.
Chief Justice Upadhyaya, Justice Dharmadhikari, Justice Chandurkar, Justice Sirpurkar, sister and brother judges, my dear Arjun and members of the Bobde family, dignitaries on the dais, dignitaries off the dais. I wish to dedicate today's lecture to three persons. The first is my dearest friend Vinod, who was my friend and colleague for many years, but who, alas, is no longer with us. The second is his equally dear wife, who passed away only a few days ago. We have had such lovely times together with both of them. And the third is my most beloved grandmother, Mrs. Banu Nariman, whose birthday was only yesterday. World War II took a huge toll. It was estimated that something like between 70 and 80 million deaths took place, most of them being civilian deaths, about 50 to 55 million. They took place because the Axis powers, so-called, aligned themselves against almost the rest of the world. And the Axis powers at that time consisted of Germany, led by Adolf Hitler, Japan, led by Emperor Hirohito, and Italy, led by Mussolini, the fascist leader who was there from 1921. On the other side, as you have just heard, you had Great Britain, France, who got knocked out relatively early, the Soviet Union, who bore the brunt of the war, and the United States, who came for the final cleanup. Now, even before the Second World War was over and Germany was defeated, Adolf Hitler committed suicide on 30th April 1945. President Truman, on 2nd May, called Justice Jackson a sitting justice of the US Supreme Court. This is something that is almost unparalleled in the history of the world, that you call upon a sitting US Supreme Court justice to step down for a long period, which is undetermined at that time, and actually formulate a trial which should take place and be the chief public prosecutor for the United States. So we find that this Nuremberg trial was really the brainchild of Justice Jackson. A little about Justice Jackson. He was an appointee of President Roosevelt, having been appointed in 1941. Unfortunately, he died by 1954. And 1 year of his justiceship on the US Supreme Court was taken away by the Nuremberg trial. He was famous not only for his dissents, but his concurring judgments as well. And above all, for the language used in his judgments, which was really the law as literature. I can only give you a smattering from two of them. One is the famous West Virginia board case, which overruled a judgment called Gobitis within 3 years in 1943. Now remember, he was a junior justice at the time. And he wrote a beautiful judgment extolling freedom of speech and upholding the right of Jehovah's Witnesses, who are an extreme Protestant group, to say that they will not salute the flag of the United States. And in particular, this was school children who had to get up and actually salute the flag. In writing his great judgment, he said, if there is one fixed star in our constitutional constellation, it is that no official, high or petty, can prescribe what shall be orthodox in matters of politics, nationalism, religion, or any other subject concerning moral choice. Beautiful words. At almost the end of his tenure, in 1951 in Brown versus Allen, he famously said about his own court, we are not final because we are infallible. We are infallible only because we are final. He had this great felicity with words. And it was he, and it was actually on his shoulders that this entire tribunal rested. There was a Moscow declaration of a sort of 1943, when the big three, that is Roosevelt, Churchill, and Stalin, got together in Moscow and decided that at the end of the war, Nazi officials shall be tried by the respective nations, which will by then be set up by the Allies and which will have democratic governments. It made an exception for major war criminals. It specifically said so, and said that they may be tried as decided by the Allied powers. Now, Jackson had to hold many meetings with officials from the other three victor countries. As a matter of fact, nobody was keen on having a trial. The English, who are famous for their rule of law, said that every Nazi war criminal should be shot. No question of trial. The Russians agreed. The French agreed. But it was Jackson who, after several meetings, hammered out a charter. And that charter was hammered out by the 8th of August 1945 in London, with the concurrence of these other powers. And the charter now did something unprecedented. It set up a military tribunal of the victors. Each victor country would choose its judges. There would have to be two of them. There would have to be one judge and an associate judge. It is only the principal judge who could decide the case, but the associate judge had to sit there and help him and fill in for him if he happened to be absent. It also outlined the procedure to be followed, which was natural justice generally. Defendants were to be given witnesses. They were allowed to cross-examine, etc. As a matter of fact, the prosecution has as many as 33 witnesses, of whom one happened to be a German field marshal, Paulus. And Paulus became a field marshal only because Hitler thought that a field marshal, a German field marshal, would never surrender. So on the eve of the surrender of Stalingrad, one of the most famous battles in World War II, he made Paulus a field marshal, but Paulus surrendered nonetheless. And he was in Soviet captivity and actually gave evidence for Soviet Russia against Nazi Germany. There were as many as 80 defendant witnesses, and that included the defendants themselves. And they included such famous figures as von Rundstedt, one of the most senior and outstanding field marshals of the war, Erich von Manstein, another outstanding field marshal of the war. It is Manstein whose great plan was to send the panzer tanks rolling through the Ardennes mountains so that they'd make a surprise attack and roll into Paris, which is what happened. And that's how France capitulated very early in World War II. And of course, you also had Field Marshal Albert Kesselring. And Kesselring was, again, a great field marshal who managed to hold out at Monte Cassino, if you remember, in Italy, against Patton's forces for almost a year. Now, all these defendant witnesses spoke for the defense. The prosecutors consisted of Justice Jackson himself. I told you that he was a sitting U.S. Supreme Court justice. Funnily enough, one of the U.S. judges, Justice Biddle, Francis Biddle, happened to be a former attorney general. So their roles were reversed. And he was assisted by Judge Parker. On the British side, you had Sir Hartley Shawcross, who was the attorney general. And you had Sir David Maxwell Fife assisting him. As prosecutors, of course, you also had the very famous Norman Burkitt. Now, Norman Burkitt, if you remember, was one of the greatest cross-examiners of his time. You had Justice Lawrence and Norman Burkitt. And Burkitt was famous for one of the most famous sentences in cross-examination, which is, what is the coefficient of expansion of brass? Now, he asked this question, which happened to be a deadly question, to an expert witness in order to destroy his expertise, which he did successfully. So you had Lawrence and Burkitt and the Attorney General and Maxwell Fife appearing for England. And similarly, for France, you had a person called De Vabre, who was a judge, and another person called Falco, who was the assistant judge. And so far as the last country was concerned, the Soviet Union, you had Rudenko and then Nikitchenko and Volchkov. Now this gives you the entire prosecution and judge team of these nations. Remember, only four judges had the right to vote. The associate judges did not. Now, the crimes for which they were supposed to be arraigned were also set down in that charter. And a number of these crimes were crimes laid down for the first time. They didn't find themselves in any earlier Geneva Convention, which led to one major criticism saying that you are trying persons criminally for crimes which were not crimes on the date on which they were committed. But nonetheless, the crimes were, first, the crime of conspiracy for waging aggressive war. The second was crimes during the war itself, perpetrated during the war. The third were crimes perpetrated during peace. And the last was the most significant, which is crimes against humanity. Because if you remember, there were millions of persons who perished in many concentration camps that were set up by the Germans, and which the victors only came to know about when they actually entered Poland, Germany, etc., and found these ghastly, emaciated, either Jews or Gypsies or Slavs or whoever. There were as many as 6 million Jews who were exterminated in these camps, and another 6 million who were Slavs, Croats, Gypsies, etc. So you had all these defendants arraigned on these four counts. Now, a little bit as to the defendants themselves. Interestingly, you had 24 persons who were arraigned. And of the 24, two couldn't stand trial. One, Robert Lay, who was a person responsible for getting the slave labor to run factories, etc., in Germany. He committed suicide before the trial started. And the other was Alfred Krupp, who was the great man who produced iron and steel in Germany. He was too sick to stand trial. So ultimately, 22 stood trial. Of the 22, it is very interesting to note that only 12 were given the death penalty. Imagine, this is a country which has waged war against the rest of the world for 6 years, exterminated millions of persons, most of whom were civilians, and only 12 death sentences were handed down. Then you had three who were given life sentences. You had four who were given sentences starting with 20 years and going down to 10 years. And again, believe it or not, you had three acquittals. Now we'll go to the 12 who were actually tried and sentenced to death. Please remember, Hitler was dead. The head of the German state was dead. His right-hand man, Goebbels, was the propaganda minister, had also committed suicide with him in the bunker. He was also dead, consequently. Himmler had also committed suicide. Himmler was the head of the SS organization, which was the black policemen, they were all dressed in black, who were exterminators par excellence. And of course, Reinhard Heydrich, who also was killed by a bomb blast. He being the head of the SD, which is the intelligence wing of the SS. I might tell you now that six organizations were also arraigned as defendants, apart from individuals. And they were the Nazi party itself, the Gestapo, which was a secret police at that time, which harassed and murdered millions of civilians. Then the SS, the SD, the Reich ministers around Hitler, and the OKW. Now, the OKW is the German military force headquarters. Of these six, four who were indicted were all declared criminal organizations. The last two, the majority judgment said, were fluid or too fluid to be tried as organizations, and therefore they escaped. Now, coming back to the 12 defendants who got death, the first who got death was the single most important man in Germany after Hitler, and he was Hermann Göring. He was called the Reich Marshal. Hermann Göring was a military ace. In fact, he was a flying pilot ace in World War I. And after World War I, he joined the Nazi party in 1924. He was there at the famous Putsch, which was the event in Munich, which they celebrated every year, and slowly rose through the ranks. He was even responsible for making Hitler Führer in 1933. He then became head of the Gestapo for a short while, which you remember was that secret police organization. He became Minister of the Interior for Prussia, which was the main state in Germany, after which he became Reich Marshal and was the head of the Luftwaffe or the Air Force. Now, this man proved to be a very obdurate and difficult witness. He was brilliant, you could see. And I've actually seen the cross-examination of Justice Jackson and how Justice Jackson had to struggle against him and how Justice Jackson had to beg the tribunal to say, look, every time I ask him a question, he doesn't say yes or no. He goes into a long harangue of his own and tries to justify what Nazi Germany did because of what was done to them after World War I. But anyway, even though he didn't succeed, finally, it was Sir David Maxwell Fife who, through a very brilliant cross-examination, got the necessary answers out of this extremely brilliant and obdurate witness. So Göring was the first man who was tried and sentenced to death. The person who followed him was Field Marshal Keitel. Now, ordinarily, field marshals who were mere field marshals who fought were not arraigned. But Field Marshal Keitel was much more than that. He was head of the OKW, which was the military wing. And he was a sort of lackey to Adolf Hitler himself. Everything Hitler wanted to do militarily and otherwise he did through Keitel. So Keitel was arraigned. Keitel was also awarded the death sentence. And fittingly enough, thanks to a botched hanging by an inexperienced American hangman, it took him something like 25 minutes ultimately for his life to snuff out on the rope on which he hanged. So you had Keitel as number two. The person who followed him was Alfred Jodl. He was a colonel general. He was the immediate deputy of Keitel, therefore did exactly the same thing that Keitel did. Now, mind you, every one of these witnesses except Göring tried to say that what we were doing was following orders, which was the main defense taken by all the witnesses. Article 8 of the military tribunal took care of that. It said that if you take up this defense, it will not absolve you of guilt, but it may go in mitigation of sentence. So the result was that all of them who said that we only followed orders didn't get very far. And people like Jodl also hanged. Now, after Jodl and after these three people, you had two Austrians who were die-hard anti-Semites. You had a man called Arthur Seyss-Inquart. He hated Jews, pathologically. And he was another person who was euphemistically called protector of the Netherlands and of Poland, in which millions of innocent people died. He also ultimately got the hangman's rope. And with him was the other Austrian, a man called Kaltenbrunner. Now, Kaltenbrunner was, again, an SS high up and actually succeeded Reinhard Heydrich as chief of the SD, which I told you was the intelligence wing of the SS. Again, a man on whose hands a huge amount of blood was. So these two Austrians now make it five. Then you had Hans Frank, who was the Governor General of Poland, in which the maximum deaths took place in concentration camps. It was very difficult to hang him. And then a person called Frick, who was Minister of the Interior and a successor to Hjalmar Schacht for the Reich Bank. He also was hanged. Then you come to the famous Alfred Rosenberg, or the infamous Alfred Rosenberg, who was considered the philosopher priest of the Nazis. He ran two newspapers, and he tried to give reasons for the extermination of the vermin race, as he called them. Along with him went Joachim von Ribbentrop, who was foreign minister. You remember the famous Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, which was done in August 1939, so that the Soviet Union could be kept out of the war, and Hitler could then go and invade France. So these two were also hanged. And finally, you also had Julius Streicher, who was a person who ran a newspaper called Der Sturm, also virulently anti-Semitic, and found to be almost of moron level when they took IQ tests. Couldn't answer questions. He just had this sort of way of hammering against a particular race without any reason. And finally, a man called Saukal, who was also a person who gathered labor in order to run the huge Nazi war machine. So these 12 were the defendants who were hanged. Now, when we come to persons who got life, and this is a little surprising, first person was Rudolf Hess. Rudolf Hess, in fact, was even more important than Hermann Göring, because he was the immediate deputy Führer for a long time until Hermann Göring took over and went beyond him during the war. He was Hitler's immediate confidant in the Landsberg prison in 1924. He took down in writing Hitler's ravings in Mein Kampf, or My Struggle, and was an ardent devotee or fan of the Führer. Now, Hess was a person who was a little mentally deranged, but thought that he would do his Führer the greatest feat which could achieve by him alone. He took a Messerschmitt, and on 10th May 1941, flew all alone to Scotland and landed in Scotland. When they picked him up, nobody believed that this was the third most important man in the Reich. He thought that he would broker a peace between Britain and Germany, and he was only following what Hitler said in Mein Kampf, because Hitler said that the moment you have a war on two fronts, you are doomed. So he said, I will go in person, broker a peace, get Britain out of the war, so that then we can attack the Soviet Union. Of course, he failed miserably. And he remained in prison throughout. In fact, he continued in prison with his life sentence. Most others were let off by then or had completed their sentences. And at age 92 in Spandau, where he was kept, he ultimately committed suicide. So Hess surprisingly got life. Incidentally, there was one judgment that was written by Justice Lawrence and concurred in by the other three powers. The Russian judges dissented. And one of the points on which they dissented was on Hess. They said, no, he was number two to Hitler. He may have slipped to number three, but he was number two. He should have been hanged. So that was one important point of dissent. The other two points of dissent by the Russians were, they said, no, every organization, including the two that were let off, were all military, all criminal. They were all scoundrels. So they also had to be declared criminal. And the third on which the Russians dissented was, they said, there cannot be acquittals. This will be a complete mockery if you have persons like this who are all bigwigs in that sense, who are standing trial, three of whom get acquitted. So we come now to the acquittals immediately. Who was acquitted? Hjalmar Schacht. He happened to be the president of the Reichsbank. And he was acquitted because he was president before the war broke out. And it was proved at least, not a sort of violent and virulent Nazi supporter. So he got completely acquitted of all four war crimes. Then apart from Hjalmar Schacht, you also had two others. One was a minor, some official in the Interior Ministry called Fritsch. He was also let out. But the third again was a very big fish. He was a man called Franz von Papen. Now von Papen happened to be Chancellor of Germany itself, helped Hitler become Chancellor in 1933, became his Vice Chancellor. Then, however, made a speech at Marburg in 1934, speaking of how Nazis generally had throttled freedom of speech, which was considered to be completely out of line by the Führer at that time. Nonetheless, he continued as minister and then ambassador to Vienna and ambassador to Turkey. So even this big fish ultimately was acquitted. So now we have three acquittals. And what about the four who were given sentences, not life sentences? Albert Speer, another very, very important person in the war, a man who wrote Inside the Third Reich after he came out of prison, was Hitler's favorite. In fact, he was his favorite architect. Hitler had dreams of being an architect, artist, etc. And he somehow took to this young man. But then ultimately, he was the person who prolonged the war because he became armaments minister. And as armaments minister, he had to engage huge slave labor. Now, despite all this, because ultimately he stood up against Hitler at the end, because Hitler had a scorched earth policy, he said, destroy everything in Germany. The other powers are going to come in and destroy, we will destroy it ourselves first. He's halted that. So ultimately, anyway, the tribunal felt that he should get 20 years. And he served his 20-year sentence and then wrote that famous book, Inside the Third Reich. Along with him, you had another person who happened to be a person who was a Hitler youth person, Baldur von Schirach. And he was the person who recruited young boys at the end of the war because there were no men left, who made that famous dash, if you remember, to Antwerp. And it was called the Battle of the Bulge at the time. And a lot of these young boys were recruited by this person. So anyway, this person also got 20 years. A person called von Neurath got 15 years because he was Reich protector of Bohemia, Moravia. And he was too soft, according to Hitler. So he was removed and Heydrich was put in. So he got 15 years. And then surprisingly, Admiral Dönitz. Now, Admiral Dönitz became Führer after Hitler, the day he committed suicide. And he was the head of the Kriegsmarine and the head of the U-boat section of the German Navy, which wreaked the most destruction on not only vessels, but the British Navy itself. Anyway, he ultimately got only 10 years. The other persons who got life were Erich Raeder, who was the person who actually, Grand Admiral, who actually built up the entire Navy. And finally, a man called Walter Funk, who also happened to be a person connected with propaganda and a successor of Hjalmar Schacht, as I told you earlier, at the Reich Bank. So with this array, you actually have, at the Nuremberg trials, one section of the rule of law being vindicated. Please remember, it is important to remember that, number one, it's a victor tribunal, as was correctly pointed out by the Chief Justice. Number two, strangely enough, there was no Italian who was arrested. Now, mind you, Italy under Mussolini waged war again against the world right till 1944. There were any number of Italian politicians, Italian generals, Italian admirals, etc., all alive, none of whom faced trial. So this was one other very major flaw that the Nuremberg trial had, for some reason, Italy was not arrayed here. When we come to the Tokyo trials, there are even bigger flaws. The Tokyo trial actually centered around one person and one person alone, Douglas MacArthur. Who was Douglas MacArthur? He was, of course, a US general. He was one of the only five-star generals. There were four others in World War II. But he was a military hero of the United States. He was also made field marshal of the Philippines Army. Eisenhower very cattily said he was made field marshal of a non-existent army. But never mind. He was still field marshal of the Philippines Army. And after the Japanese onslaught on the Philippines in 1942, he had to retreat and walk out with all his troops and went to Australia for 2 years. And ominously said, I shall return. And return he did in 1944. And you have that very famous photograph of this man with dark goggles actually walking in the water and coming up to the mainland in the Philippines. Now, he as Supreme Allied Commander for the East himself drew up a military tribunal charter like the one at Nuremberg. This was, mind the way, not government sponsored. This was done by him alone in his capacity as Supreme Commander. He borrowed heavily from the charter, but there were two or three important differences. One was, you didn't have four countries here, you had 11 countries. Apart from the four we spoke about, you had Canada, you had Australia, you had New Zealand, you had China, you had India, we were there as well, and you had the Philippines and the Netherlands, making up 11 nations. So you had judges appointed from 11 nations. Again, big difference. The judges were appointed by MacArthur, not by their individual countries, as was done in Nuremberg. Finally, the charter said that MacArthur as Supreme Commander could also review their judgments. He could review them downwards but not upwards, which meant that suppose somebody was given 20 years, he could make it 10 years, but he couldn't make it life. Now these 11 sat and the Tokyo trials began. The Nuremberg trials, I told you, took 1 year. The Tokyo trials took 2.5 years. There were 419 witnesses examined on both sides. And ultimately, the Tokyo trial yielded by a majority, there were five judgments written, by a majority, 16 life sentences and 7 death sentences, making 23. And if you add to 23, two, then two others who were foreign ministers got 20 years and 7 years. So 25 ultimately were indicted, though 28 were arraigned, like in Germany. Two were too sick to stand trial, and one had committed suicide. So 28 became 25. And as I told you, the 7 death sentences were actually meted out to 2 prime ministers. One was a man called Tojo, and another man called Hideki. So these two prime ministers were part of persons who got the death sentence. The others were generals, admirals. And the 16 who got life were from every walk of life, politicians, civilians, judges, etc. And what is interesting in these trials is the fact that Justice Webb, who was the Australian judge and was the president of these 11 judges, spoke about Hirohito's not being arraigned. Now, Hirohito's not being arraigned would have been something like Adolf Hitler, had he been alive, not being arraigned for Nuremberg. So it was a very serious gaffe. And it was done on purpose. Because MacArthur felt that unlike Germany, which had been defeated and divided, Japan must continue. And it will continue as an American protectorate. And who better to continue it than the emperor himself, because everybody believed in the emperor. So the emperor had to be kept from being tried. This was one very major flaw. Justice Webb, the Australian judge, made it clear, yes, this was a very major flaw. But nonetheless, they are all now before us. They have committed huge crimes. By the way, here there were 9 crimes. 55 became 9. And the 9 crimes were largely, really 2 crimes. Conspiracy to wage aggressive war, and war crimes committed against country X, country Y, etc., which is why they became 9 indictments. Now, on these 9 indictments, as I told you, 16 got life and 7 got death sentences. What is also important to remember in the Japanese trials is now the dissenting judgments. You had a dissent by the French judge, a man called Bernard. But unfortunately, it was a dissent only in form, in substance, though he dissented on many points, including ex post facto laws, procedural problems, etc. He ultimately signed the majority judgment. Then you had Jara Nila, who was the Filipino judge, who then went on to say that what has been meted out by way of sentence is too mild. So he did sign the majority judgment, but he said, no, most of these people should have got death for the things that they did. So he also was a dissentient in that sense. But there were 2 other dissents which were interesting. One was from the Netherlands judge, Rolling. He would have acquitted 5 persons and given different sentences to the others. And of course, our own Justice Radha Vinod Pal. He wrote this 1,200 odd page judgment. And what he said was very interesting for all future military tribunals. First, he said, Japan may have been actually waging a defensive war against the colonialism from Western powers. Then he went on to say, probably correctly, that all these were criminal offenses only at the time of the charter and not at the time they were committed. So for that reason also, everybody had to be acquitted. But the most important reason he gave was that the victors themselves ought to have been because they dropped 2 atom bombs. Now the 2 atom bombs killed as many as 150 to 200,000 people in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, most of them being civilians. So he drew attention to the single most important fact that it is the victor ultimately who seems to be meting out his own justice. And if the victor ultimately metes out his own justice? Where is the rule of law? So we find now at the end of this talk, 3 strands which emerge. One is that you saw that Italians were not arrayed at all. So completely arbitrary prosecution. You also saw that the head of the Japanese was not arrayed, Hirohito. May have been for pragmatic reasons, but surely pragmatic reasons cannot absolve Adolf Hitler if a new German state were to be put up. So that was one other very major flaw. And the third most major flaw was the victor's own war crimes were never looked into. A utopian dream, which may become reality in the future, thanks to Justice Radha Vinod Pal, is having a charter first drawn up by an organization like the UN, which clearly outlines what are war crimes, so that you never have this finger pointing at you saying they are all ex post facto. So clearly delineate what a war crime is, first. Second, provide for judges from neutral countries. Very important, because if the victor is to decide about the vanquished, necessarily there will be inbuilt bias. So have neutral judges, again set up by a UN charter or some other world body. And third, that without looking at either the victor or the vanquished, arraign those responsible for war crimes. For it is only then that we can, even as a people, as human beings, look forward to universal world peace, which has thus far eluded us and probably will elude us, at least in the near future. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, my lord. Thank you, my lord, for such a fascinating historical perspective of the World War II and the impact it had on the development of the rule of law. For young lawyers like me, it brings to us the era of darkness into a whole new light. It will surely help us in the better understanding of the rule of law and its facets. I now invite Shri Atul Pandey, President of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly felicitate Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Nariman with a shawl, Shreepar, and memento as a token of our gratitude for delivering this profoundly insightful lecture. I now request Advocate Amol Jaltare, Secretary of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly felicitate the Honorable the Chief Justice Shri Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya with a shawl, Shreepar, and memento as a token of our appreciation for gracing us with his august presence. I now request Advocate Pankaj Tirke, Vice President of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly felicitate Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar with a shawl, Shreepar, and memento as a token of our appreciation and heartfelt gratitude for persistently encouraging and supporting us in all our endeavors. I request Advocate Sharad Bhattar, Vice President of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly felicitate Honorable Shri Justice B.P. Dharmadhikari with a memento as a token of our deepest gratitude for truly being a patron-in-chief of the study circle and always taking out time from his busy schedule to support and enlighten us. I now request our President, Shri Atul Pandey, to kindly present a memento to Shri Arjun Bobde as a token of our appreciation and gratitude for his valuable contribution to the study circle. I now request Advocate Amol Jaltare, Secretary of the High Court Bar Association, to kindly propose the formal vote of thanks.
A very good evening to all the dignitaries sitting on and of the dais. Greetings to all on the auspicious occasion of Navratri. Sabhi upasthit manyavaron ko Navratri ke pavan parv par anek hardik shubhkamnaye. The esteemed speaker of today's function, Honorable Shri Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman, former Judge Supreme Court of India, Honorable Shri Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyay, the Chief Justice Bombay High Court, Honorable Shri Justice Atul Chandurkar, Administrative Judge, Bombay High Court, Nagpur Bench, Honorable Shri Justice Bhushan Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice Bombay High Court and Patron-in-Chief of the Study Circle Activity, Honorable Judges of Bombay High Court at Nagpur Bench, Honorable Shri V.S. Sirpurkar, former Judge Supreme Court of India, his better half, Senior Advocate Srimati Kumkum Sirpurkar, Mrs. Sanaya Nariman, Honorable former Judges of Bombay High Court, my dear brothers and sisters, I take this opportunity to express my sincere vote of thanks to all those with whose constant endeavor support the program is now turning out to be a good, successful one. First of all, on behalf of the High Court Bar Association, I extend a sincere and deep sense of gratitude to Honorable Chief Justice Rohinton Fali Nariman for sparing his valuable time and delivering a lecture on the topic of Nuremberg and Tokyo trials, the rule of law vindicated. Vinod, we are thankful to you for letting us know as to how, pursuant to World War, an attempt was made to stifle the delivery of minority opinion to Tokyo war trials. Just to quote from your own book, Vinod's, which was gifted to me by my brother, Mr. Sangram, sir, it has been quoted that as three of the, out of the 11 judges adjudicating the trial arrived late to a particular meeting held at that time, wherein eight judges already agreed that there would be no separate or dissenting view. However, in spite of that, Justice Radha Benupal opted to go for a dissenting view, which runs into almost about 200 pages. Vinod, we are grateful to you for such eloquent address to this August gathering and the bar. Further, Vinod, I extend a sincere gratitude to Honorable Chief Justice Devendra Kumar Upadhyaya, sir, for gracing this function as the chief guest in this inaugural lecture, which is basically the study circle activity, which is basically aimed at grooming the youngsters and new members of the bar. Thank you, my lord, for your address to the bar. This is the first visit of my lord to the Nagpur bar, and I hope this would be a memorable one. We welcome you in the Orange City, my lords. I am grateful to Honorable Chief Justice Abdul Chandurkar, Senior Administrative Judge, Bombay High Court at Nagpur Bench, for his constant and valuable guidance and support to the team at HCBA in all our endeavors. I extend my sincere gratitude to Honorable Chief Justice Bhushan Dharmadhikari, former Chief Justice, Bombay High Court, and Patron in Chief. I am also thankful to respected former Judge Supreme Court of India, Mr. V.S. Sirpurkar. I am also thankful to Ms. Sanaya Nariman, who is present today, and I hope you had a good stay. And I think this would be a memorable one for you as well. I am grateful to you. I am thankful to Advocate Mr. Arjun Bobde for his generous and valuable contribution for the development of the study circle activity in the Nagpur High Court Bar Association. I am grateful to all the Honorable Judges of Bombay High Court at Nagpur Bench. I am also thankful to former judges who are present over here. I am thankful to Mr. Rajesh Joshi, Registrar General, respected judges from the District Court, Mr. Anil Sharma, sir, Secretary, respected seniors, presiding officers of various tribunals, members of the registry for the active and constant support, respected and distinguished senior advocates, in charge government pleader Mr. Anand Deshpande, Mr. Nandesh Deshpande, Mr. Rahul Pandey, the State Information Commissioner, members of media and press, I am truly thankful to you all for your gracious presence over here. I am also grateful to the principals, head of the department, faculty members of the various law colleges, the young future lawyers, the students of law colleges, for their presence in this lecture. I am also thankful and truly grateful to Advocate Bhavandas Kulkarni for his constant support and guidance. So also I am thankful to Asta Sharma, the master of the ceremony. Before I part with my formal vote of thanks, now let me announce one more thing, that the next lecture in this study circle activity would be on the topic of enforceable contracts, allied laws and remedies. With this, I conclude with the hope of participation of all the lawyers, more particularly budding lawyers, in the study circle activity. Thank you all. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. I request everyone present to kindly rise for the national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Hai Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkada Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna निधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
थैंक यू
The members of the executive committee are requested to come on the dais. Kind attention. Members of the executive committee, please come on the dais. May I request the mentors of the study circle to please come on the dais? Firdos sir, Akshay, Virat, Makran Agnihotri sir.